Well, ladies and gentlemen, presenters, welcome to tonight's Proactive Investor One-to-One Virtual Forum. And I hope you all had a superb Easter. Well, it's going to be a superb evening tonight because we are hearing from three wonderful companies in this order: Canada Silver Cobalt, Galliford Tri, and Accesso Technology Group. Three companies and four presenters tonight, and you'll find out why that is divisible. So 20 minutes per presentation and 10 minutes Q&A, where you, those of you who've joined us on the Webinar Jam platform, can get involved and type some questions into the chat and Q&A function. Okay, to our first company now, and it has the highest silver grades in the world. The company is Canada Silver Cobalt, and it's not just silver in its portfolio, but nickel and cobalt, copper and lithium. So to hear more about the company's precious and battery metals, I am delighted we're joined again by President and Chief Operating Officer Matt Halliday. A very warm welcome to you, Matt. We're very much looking forward to hearing the continuation of your very exciting story.
Thank you, Sarah. It's a pleasure to be back with Proactive tonight. And well, here in Canada, actually, it's at the early afternoon, but I'm very happy to be here and presenting today. So yes, Canada Silver Cobalt. We have a our flagship property is a silver cobalt deposit in Northern Ontario. We have focused in the Ontario and Quebec corridor in North America, and we have a large number of battery metals projects on the go, including lithium, nickel, copper, and cobalt. This presentation can actually be downloaded from our website, canadasilvercobaltworks.com. You can see the forward-looking statements and disclaimer here. So there's some exciting news. We're moving forward towards getting our spin out, Koniagus Battery Metals, which will be the Graal property. We're working on a revised technical report, and then the rest of the legal work that takes place afterwards to be able to spin that out. So we're very excited. It should drive shareholder value, and we're going to give a share and a warrant to our current shareholders. And some of those details have been press released over the last year. So feel free to look up some of the details of how it should look in the future for the spin out of Graal. And Graal has had some exciting news. You know, recently we hit about 28 meters of semi and massive sulfides with about 1.2% nickel equivalent. So we're really excited about the phase two results of the Graal and to continue that in Koniagus Battery Metals. So the staying with Canada Silver Cobalt, of course, is the Castle East. And we've had some excellent news coming out of Castle East. And we also have infrastructure that's ready and available for us to be able to operate in this camp in the future. And I'll talk a little bit further about that. So it's very exciting times at the Castle, and of course, our other battery metals projects. So the Castle is basically in the Abitibi Greenstone Belt, in the Cobalt Embayment, and just south of the Cadillac Larder Fault Zone. We're in a very prolific area. Lots of mining activity happens here, and lots of fresh discoveries. We also have our Temiskaming Testing Laboratory, which is a mill facility and analytical facility in the town of Cobalt, which is on the map. And we have our EB Auto property, which is just outside of Kirkland Lake. So, you know, The Cobalt camp is a historic silver camp that contains a large amount of conflict-free cobalt as well. There's been over 500 million ounces of silver produced from this camp and over 30 million pounds of cobalt. So going forward, basically, we want to become a silver producer with a cobalt byproduct and be able to produce that conflict-free cobalt here in North America. We have the past producing Castle Mine. This mine has produced over 9.5 million ounces of silver and over 300,000 pounds of cobalt. It was last operated in 1989. We are working diligently at revising a closure plan at the castle, and hopefully we'll be getting in underground and doing continued exploration and bulk sampling in the future. Castle East is where we have our fresh discovery. It's about a kilometer and a half kind of east-southeast of the castle mine. You can see on this map, we have a lot of historic mines in the area. And we believe that our land position is an excellent land position. We are east of the historic work, slightly deeper into the Miller Lake Basin, which is where this silver and cobalt mineralization is hosted. And I think we have a strong opportunity to find the next mines there. The historic production in this small area in the corner of the Miller Lake Basin was about 60 million ounces of silver. So, you know, we hope to find that next 60 to 100 million ounces of silver there. We've hit some pretty phenomenal grades. This is a narrow vein deposit. We've hit grades up to 40,000, 50,000, 70,000, even up to 89,000 grams per ton, typically over about 0.3 to 0.6 meters. In March of 2020, released a maiden resource where we have about 7.5 million ounces of silver inferred at around 250 ounce per ton. So it's very high grade. And we've continued to explore the Miller Lake Basin. What I think is very exciting, and maybe I haven't talked about since the last time I was with everybody at Proactive and online, is that we hit this 4,710 grams per ton, or 151 ounce per ton silver, around 65 meters down hole, which is only about 50 meters below the surface. And that's our closest high grade silver intercept to date. We released that in November 14th of 2022. And I'm very excited that that we have an opportunity now to go back to the castle and do some shallow drilling to try to identify one of these high grade panels nearer the surface. Not only can we do shallow drilling near surface there, but we can also do a stripping program and hopefully find if one of these veins comes right up to the surface. So in that area, we have a good chance of intercepting this in the surface lithology. So very excited. You know, this is again about 350 meters shallower than the Robinson zone and the Big Silver zone. So this is really good news. Not only that, but it is in an area. So on this map here, there's a white star. That's where we hit this 4,710 grams per ton. And it's right next to a intercept of 24.95 grams per ton gold near surface around 50 meters depth as well. So we're now evaluating the castle property for some of its gold potential. Again, we are in the Abitibi Greenstone Belt, and we have Archean rocks and that do have that potential for bearing gold. And our next step is to understand what's the relationship here. So is it shear hosted or is it just further to understand if there's a relationship between the silver and the gold mineralization? Just anecdotally, the historic production from the castle has had gold values in the silver pour. So it's really an important piece to the puzzle and can add economics to the project. So this new zone that we're looking at that is near surface is very close to where we had a conceptual ramp portal. I think that, by delineating this new zone, we can potentially have ourselves in a place that we can get down to the silver and do bulk sampling and get this ramp up and running cheaper and quicker. Like to mention our EB Auto gold property. It's near Kirkland Lake, and it's just south of the Cadillac Larder Fault. We've done a lot of work on the property over the last year, and we've completed some high resolution drone magnetics. We've done field IP and inverted model there. We've done bedrock stripping. We've drilled four holes. We are potentially going to go back and follow up on some of these IP targets and continue our work at the EB Auto property. Recently, we also picked up the Saint-Denis property. The Saint-Denis property is 240 square kilometers. It's a very large property package around the Power Metals Corp Case Lake deposit. This will be a greenfield exploration project. And I think we have staked ground that is of high potential for finding LCT type pegmatites. We have an excellent plan for the summer and following up on targets. So we'll be moving forward with that in the near future. As we've mentioned, we have a large number of battery metals projects across Ontario and Quebec. They span basically from near Sudbury to the northeast of Quebec. The Graal is one of those projects, which is going to be spun out into Koniagus Battery Metals. But we have a bunch of other high-value projects, Lac Edouard, Fuchsia, Farg, that I would like to continue to evaluate and potentially do a joint venture or partnership with other companies to accelerate these other deposits. We've done a lot of work so far on these deposits in terms of data compilation and some of the airborne mag and gravity, as well as some inversions of that. So we're starting to get a really good picture of what's the best targets and how we can move forward with exploration. At the Graal, an excellent property that has a large 6 kilometer EM conductor on this map. It's a big red kind of arc, and we had some excellent historic drilling on the site, and we've drilled thus so far just under 17,000 meters in multiple phases that included both in between phases of drilling, additional geophysics. This is some of the highlights from the Graal. Again, we've been hitting massive and semi-massive pyrrhotite sulfide that contains copper, nickel, and cobalt, plus or minus some PGEs. And most recently, here is from the phase two drilling. We've hit this Graal GRL 2260. We have basically 28.9 meters of massive and semi-massive sulfides that have about 1.12 nickel equivalent. So we're very excited about continuing to hit these sulfides at this magmatic deposit and continuing to do work there. And eventually become grow this to a size that it can become its own mine in the future. So some of the other properties that we have, we do have the Lac Edouard property, which is next door to Rio Tinto. We have a large Bugie anomaly there. I would love to be able to explore Lac Edouard this year. We have the Forg property, which is north of the Graal. And again, we have this very large Bugie anomaly kind of surrounded by a mag anomaly. And I believe that there's a lot of potential in these properties. We also have the Henry Lake property near Sudbury, where we've recently expanded some of the staking. And it has potential for copper nickel plus mostly PGMs. Our fuchsia property, also north of the Graal, in the same area, is it's a very large package. It's about 22 kilometers across. We have the some historic intercepts there, as well as a bunch of historic showings on the property. I think there's a lot of potential here for continued exploration. It's a very, as I mentioned, it's a very large package, and it's about 22 kilometers across. There's a very strong geophysical anomaly there, and there's been some pretty good intercepts to date. So we need to target the right lithology and the right interface, and come up with a good exploration plan to prove out the fuchsia. This is our high grade facility in the town of Cobalt, and so we have again an analytical facility plus a ball mill, a cone crusher, and a bullion furnace. So when the time comes that the castle is ready to be bulk sampling or mining, we do have a place to produce the silver doré bars. In addition to that, we have the ONE2ONE process. It's a closed loop hydrometallurgical process, very green, no smelting, and it can produce cobalt sulfate on spec for industry. We've produced a 22.6% cobalt sulfate for a supplier in Asia back in 2018, and it can also produce nickel, copper, cobalt sulfates as well. And it can remove any of the deleterious elements and reject that. So it is very efficient at removing arsenic and potentially antimony and bismuth, which are critical minerals here in Canada. So being able to remove the bismuth and antimony could be another byproduct from the cobalt mining camp that is a critical metal that is of interest to most of the nations for electrification. So our basic design is to operate a hub and spoke type system. And we will have the mill and a leach plant in the town of Cobalt, and we'll be able to onboard multiple projects into this hub and spoke system and do toll processing for other mines, as well as assist our colleagues here in the cobalt mining camp to be able to become a camp that can produce conflict-free cobalt for the world. So basically, you know, what we would do is we would basically separate silver cons and a cobalt con, and we'll be able to produce silver as a primary metal, and we can produce the cobalt and the other materials through the ONE2ONE process as a secondary commodity. And we have an excellent team. Myself, I'm a resource geologist. I have about 15 to 20 years of experience working with various types of deposits. I've worked for companies like SGS Minerals, Kirkland Lake Gold, First Cobalt here in the Cobalt Mining Camp, and I live right here in the Cobalt Mining Camp. So I'm very passionate about where I live and the projects around here. Frank Bassa also is an experienced metallurgist with over 40 years of experience. He actually started off his career here in the Cobalt Mining Camp with Agnico Eagle. And so he brings a wealth of knowledge as a metallurgical engineer with a lot of metallurgical and engineering and mining experience over the last 40 years. I'd like to mention Gerhard Kiesling, our VP Exploration, very experienced geologist here in the Abitibi Greenstone Belt, working for a lot of the majors here. Diane Tukini is one of our board members, and she is a First Nations consultant and helps us develop these relationships and progress in a very sustainable way our relationships with communities and making sure that we honor those agreements. And Claude Duplessis is the consultant to the company. He's leading up our Quebec battery metals exploration. And that is my presentation today.
And thank you very much, Matt. Now, you used the word love. Whether you mentioned you were aware that you'd used it enough, but you said you would love to explore Lac Edward. So will you make this so in 2023? Because that was the only time you mentioned anything of a romantic nature.
Oh, well, Lac Edward is a very enticing project. I guess, you know, I would love to explore there. There is a past producing mine just north of our property. It produced 1.5% nickel, 0.5% copper. And I think that, you know, it was probably the smaller deposit of what could be a much larger deposit in the area. Not only that, but it's about 2 hours north of a port town on the St. Laurent River. And it has a power line running through the property. So, you know, being close to ports, having access to power, being near what was a fairly decent grade producer, I think it's an excellent opportunity. Plus the neighbors are Rio Tinto, and I think that that bodes well, that there could be some good partnership there in the future if we do find some mineralization at Lac Edward.
So you've certainly got Brian excited. He says all of the intercepts are really exciting, but he says, how do you plan to monetize these results over the medium term?
Well, I think in the medium term, I think, you know, Canada Silver Cobalt has a couple of things that it needs to accomplish. One of them is, you know, in the short term, we need to get the Koniagas battery metals up and running and get the Graal into its own vehicle and really drive shareholder value that way. I think that a lot of these other battery metal projects that we have need to follow a similar agenda, where we need to be able to work with other partners, or, you know, whether it's a joint venture, whether it's an option agreement, whether it's some other type of arrangement, so we can get the most out of these properties. So I would really like to be working with the community to be able to advance these projects and get these results out to the market.
So you're talking about spinning out Graal into its own vehicle. Will this be a major liquidity event for the company? You know, will it be same management, or will you have a significant share ownership? How do you think it will work to the benefit of existing shareholders?
Right. So the way it's basically designed right now is about 33% of the new shares would be issued to the current shareholders of Canada Silver Cobalt Works. And I don't know the exact ratio. I mean, it needs to be revised, and it still needs to be approved by shareholders in the future. But, you know, we did cite a number of 1-17 with a quarter warrant. Then another 33% would be retained by Canada Silver Cobalt. So we would have a stake in the new company, and then we would have fresh financing to top up the new company and get it up and running.
So I'm thinking about the revenue streams for the current company. There's two, possibly three, in fact, four, I reckon. The revenue streams, the economics of harvesting both the base metals and silver, then adding value by processing it into premium EV battery metal. You've got that. Then there was the stroke of genius when you acquired the assay lab and bulk processing facility located in the town where you live. So, you know, how is that going? Have you got queues of prospectors wanting to avail of the facilities you have there?
Well, not quite yet, but I think in the very near future. We are basically up and ready to operate now. So I invite people to come and talk to me. We have an excellent lab manager there at the facility. So basically, we're ready to go pretty much this month.
All right. So April is going to be a significant month. In fact, I'm just wondering how significant 2023 as a whole is going to be, because 2021, the company was very acquisitive. 2022, last year, the company acquired 200 square kilometers of prospective lithium properties that you've mentioned. So 2023, is it going to be a year of consolidation, or is there more acquisitions to come if a tantalizing asset is presented to you?
I don't think that there's going to be a year of acquisition this year. I think that we have a lot on our plate, and we really need to effectively and decisively exploit what we have right now. And I think that there's the opportunities to, again, do partnerships and to work these properties ourselves, as well as getting the Graal up and running and hopefully it being able to share some of the load in the battery metal space.
So you've got the First Nations consultant. She's been with you for some time. Is she also good at recruitment? Because it sounds as though it can't just all rest on your shoulders, even though you are a geologist of some repute. So in terms of getting the right people to assist in terms of the exploration and the exploitation, albeit sustainably, is there enough people out there available to help you grow?
Sure. It's a difficult time, but we have an excellent team here at Canada Silver Cobalt with excellent geologists and excellent technicians. And I think that we have the abilities to recruit high quality, high caliber people and be able to deliver the product at the end of the day that we need to deliver.
So you're saying that it's difficult times. It's difficult times universally. And Trevor said, conditions for mining companies looking to raise money are not great at the moment. Do you see investor sentiment turning more positive as the year progresses?
I do. I see next month going to be a lot more positive, honestly. I think there's a shift on the horizon. And I really think that the second half of 2023 is going to be a very interesting time of year.
So is that sector specific or company specific?
I think a little both.
There's something you're not telling us. So let's wrap this up by reminding people about, so we can see the portfolio of assets you've got. Brian was wanting to know how you're going to monetize this, but there are revenue streams coming online. So just remind us about the revenue streams that are available to the company, because I counted four. There may be more that I'm not aware of.
Well, we have the analytical facility and the mill facility. And so that is coming online now as we speak. And hopefully we'll be retaining new customers there. We have some new legislation. I didn't talk about this, but we have some new legislation in Ontario. And so there's something called a recovery permit where we could potentially start recovering tailings in the cobalt mining camp, slightly easier than under the previous legislation. So that's a potential. Of course, the castle is moving forward, and we are looking at that shallow mineralization, which gets us a little bit closer, and there's a lot of opportunity. Canada Silver Cobalt has, and I should not forget the R2OX process, which we need to look forward to being able to globalize that process and be able to deliver the ability to remove some of these deleterious elements and extract not only extract, but extract and produce value-added products like the cobalt sulfate, nickel sulfate, copper sulfate.
Yeah, and the critical minerals that are essential, particularly to Canada. Well, I am fascinated as to what's going to be happening towards the end of the year, but I'm quite sure that you're not able to tell us, otherwise you would have. Matthew Holliday, thank you very much indeed. It's always a pleasure, and we're really looking forward to hearing about the spin-out as it progresses towards reality. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you, and thank you for your questions. Right, keep those questions coming in for our next companies. So if you attended our physical event last week, you might remember Hercules Site Services and their extraction sucking equipment. Very exciting. Our next company is one of their clients. It is Galliford Try, £190 million market cap construction group, which operates as Galliford Try and Morrison Construction. It told investors about yet another contract today. The finance director is Andrew Duxbury, who must be feeling very pleased with the reaction to the RNS statement today.
Yeah, very pleased. And that was a really nice contract award, Sarah. So thank you. Thanks for hosting the event again. As you say, Galliford Try constructs economic and social infrastructure across the UK. So what I'll do this evening, I'll just do a little reprise of our half year results through to December 2022. And then I'll spend a bit more time on the outlook and the strategy for the business going forwards. So if I just start with some of the headlines for the half year period just finished. We're really pleased with the performance that we posted for the period up to the end of December. And that, of course, is thanks to all of my colleagues across the UK. We showed disciplined growth in revenue and in our operating margin. All of our businesses are performing well, and our acquisitions that we've made over the last 18 months are settling in really nicely. And you can see on the slide that we increased our half year profit before tax to 11.7 million pounds and increased our divisional operating margin to 2.3% in line with our strategic objectives. Our balance sheet remains very strong, and our interim dividend was increased 36% to 3 pence per share. And looking forward, the order book, I'll come back to this in more detail, the order book is very robust. We've got a strong pipeline of opportunities behind that. And of course, the Carlisle Road that we announced today is an example of that strong pipeline. So putting that together, we're really confident in achieving our full year FY23, June 2023 financial targets. In a nutshell, the investment proposition for the business is that we're a high quality business. We're operating in very robust markets, and we're generating increasing returns for our shareholders. The market opportunity is very strong. We're not a particularly cyclical business. The market opportunity stays strong through the economic cycle. And it's really supported by good levels of government investment. Really importantly, we've got a culture embedded through the business which is focused on risk and discipline and all aligned to delivering the strategy that we've set. Our financial position is very strong. We're demonstrating our track record of delivering consistent, predictable financial results. And we've got a really clear strategy in place, and that strategy will deliver increased shareholder returns. So just giving a little bit more detail on the half year results through, and say this is through to the end of December 2022, you can see our revenue in the period was up 14%. We split that between our two divisions, building, which builds schools and healthcare facilities and magistrates courts and prisons and so on. Buildings revenue was up 3.5%. And there was some delay in contract signings, new contract signings last year. That's really now starting to ease, but that probably held back the growth of buildings revenue last year. The other division is infrastructure. That really is highways and then water, wastewater and clean water treatment works. And you can see infrastructure's revenue was up 35%. And that benefited by the acquisition that we made in autumn 2021. But most of that increase was driven by our environment business. But more importantly, you can see on the right-hand side, the divisional operating margin for both divisions showed progress in the period, and we're much more focused on margin delivery. So our pre-exceptional operating profit before amortization was up 57%, £10.8 million, and pre-exceptional profit before tax was up 65% to £11.7 million. Our tax rate has increased in the period. It was 19.5%, and of course tax rates are increasing, and we're increasing with that standard increase in corporation tax. So as a result, our earnings per share increased 49% to 8.8 pence per share. Really importantly, we've got a very strong balance sheet. This is important to us. It's important to us in the marketplace. It's important for our clients in helping us to win work with good quality clients. And of course, it's important for our supply chain. It gives our supply chain confidence and helps us to contract with the best supply chain in the industry. So the balance sheet is a really important operational differentiator for us. Galliford Try has got no pension funds, so no pension liabilities, and we've got no debt. We've got a robust, strong cash position each and every day of the year. And we think good contractors should have that sort of strong balance sheet. And as you can see, that generated us interest income of £2 million in the half year, and that will increase through the second half through our PPP asset portfolio of £46 million. Our average month-end cash was £154 million, and the period-end cash at the end of December was £196 million. A little bit lower than last year because of the acquisitions that we've done, but still a very strong cash position. So that balance sheet is a really important part of our strategy going forwards. And we prioritise that strong balance sheet. As I've already said, this is a competitive advantage. It gives confidence to our clients and to our supply chain. It really supports the disciplined approach to contracting that we have in the business, and really helps to alleviate any risk of any adverse market conditions that we may see. The balance sheet also helps us to invest in our business, in our people, in quality, in digital assets, and also in our adjacent markets, including, when appropriate, acquisitions. And we've made 3 acquisitions over the last 18 months, the acquisitions of MCS and Ham Baker in the 6 months ended December 2022. The balance sheet also then allows us to deliver sustainable, strong shareholder returns. And you can see we're able to pay a growing dividend. That dividend was up 36% in the half year compared to the previous half year. And we've also said that we will return excess cash to our shareholders as that becomes available. And we've got a £15 million share buyback program underway at the moment. And of course, that will be accretive to earnings for our shareholders going forwards. So now I just want to move a little bit more onto the outlook for the business as we go forwards. I think it's really important. Our marketplace is really robust, really resilient at the moment. And that resilience really underpins the growth that we expect in our core markets. And we've got some really strong positions in our core sectors that I'll come on to a little bit later when I talk through the order book. But examples of the sectors that we work in are education, so building schools, probably building typically 30 or 40 schools at any one time across the country. Healthcare facilities, I've mentioned clean and wastewater treatment facilities, and highways. And the drivers of growth in these markets are there in terms of demographics, in terms of the aging infrastructure in the UK, in terms of the UK's need to invest in increased productivity. So the drivers of growth in our core markets are strong and resilient. In addition, we're able to support our clients' objective of decarbonisation. So it's our clients are increasingly looking for buildings and infrastructure which is more carbon efficient in use, and in due course, more carbon efficient in the construction as well. So we're helping to support our clients on that journey. And that's a really increasingly important route to market for us. And I would say, I'll come on to this a little bit more in a moment, that the overall macroeconomic conditions have certainly improved over the last 6 months as well. So just to touch on that in a little bit more detail. 2022, as we know, calendar year 2022 was a challenging year for all sorts of reasons. And we were able to respond to those key economic challenges. We were able to manage those. And there was no overall impact on our financial results as coming through because of these challenges. So we were able to successfully manage these through. So, and we're starting to see all of these issues really start to ease now. So inflation I would say, yeah, we manage that by pricing inflation and pricing our contracts very sensibly, ensuring we had the right contractual protections in our contracts, making sure we've got the right collaborative relationships with our clients and with our supply chain. And we are now seeing inflation much more predictable, much more stable than we were seeing this time last year. So that's very helpful. You know, similarly, if I look at materials availability, if we'd spoken 12 months ago, this was an issue in terms of making sure that we had materials arriving on site at the right time. Generally, that's no longer an issue, but we've retained a lot of those disciplines about early procurement, early planning to make sure that we're able to continue to mitigate those issues. And then similarly, retaining excellent people in the business, really important, as well as attracting good new people to the business. And we spent a lot of time investing in our employee value proposition over the last few months. We've got a very low employee churn rate, which is great because that means people are wanting to stay and develop their careers with Galliford Try. And we invest very heavily in our early careers population, so apprentices, trainees, graduates. And again, that's a really good investment for the future of the business. So we've been able to successfully manage these macroeconomic challenges last year. And so these typically are starting to ease as we come through this this new calendar year. So our strategy is very straightforward. And you can see a summary of that on the slide. We want to deliver high quality buildings and infrastructure. We want to deliver that in a socially responsible way. And we want to deliver that in a way which provides a sustainable return for our shareholders. So you can see the four cornerstones of our strategy on the slide. First and foremost, we want to invest in our people, being a very people-oriented, progressive business. Of course, absolutely top of the tree there is health and safety, making sure that all of our people can go home safely at the end of every day. But it's also about mental health and well-being. It's also about career development. It's also about diversity, inclusivity. So actually making sure we've got the best cohort of people in the business is first and foremost how we'll deliver our strategy. Secondly, I want to, on the bottom left there, we want to make sure we deliver our strategy in a socially responsible way. That means about thinking about the environment, about the communities that we operate in. And for example, social value, that's about using a local supply chain, local labor, local employment, is something which is very important to our clients and something which helps us to win work across the UK. On the top right there, we want to focus on delivering excellence. We want to focus on a culture of quality, of innovation. So this is about investment in digital. This is about investment in the supply chain, investment in our clients. This is about paying our supply chain properly so that we can work with the best clients and we can have the best supply chain wanting to work with Galliford Try as well. And if we get those cornerstones of the strategy right, then we'll be able to deliver sustainable, predictable, consistent financial returns and returns for our shareholders. So what does that mean in terms of what does that look like in terms of what the strategy will deliver? Well, by 2026, we expect to be delivering revenue of £1.6 billion with a divisional operating margin of 3%. And we'll do that by growing in our existing markets. So the existing markets I've already referred to in building, in highways, in environment, because of the market fundamentals, we're able to see growth opportunities and drive the margin through those existing markets. At the same time, we're investing in what we call adjacent markets. So these are markets that we know and understand, but they're just kind of the next step along the value chain from those existing markets. And these are typically higher margin sectors that we're moving into. So the first of these is the private rented sector or the build to rent sector. So we build a lot of private rented apartment blocks for our clients. What we're now starting to do is to get involved in the upfront developments of the identification of land, taking that land through the planning and statutory consent process. And then we can take the developer margin as well as the construction margin in due course. Green retrofit is a market that we see a growing opportunity. And this is about retrofitting existing buildings, whether that be about putting photovoltaics on the roof all the way through to gutting a building and rebuilding it from the inside with all the new ventilation systems, potentially new glazing, new heating systems, and so on. And within the water sector, we design, develop, commission, water and wastewater treatment works. What we're now looking to do is to move into the capital maintenance and asset optimization of those same works. And the acquisitions that we've made over the last couple of years have really given us a strong foothold in that market. And as we look forward, we see this as a real growing market for the water companies who need to get better use of their existing assets and infrastructure, as well as investing in new infrastructure. So we're making really good progress on our revenue targets. We're making, more importantly, good progress on our margin targets. And all of these targets are underpinned by sustainability commitments. We typically report on those commitments once a year at the full year, because we measure those across a 12-month period. But you can see on the bottom of the screen there just some of the examples. We received the Bronze Award from Clear Assured. That's about diversity and inclusivity within the business. We were Water Contractor of the Year last year. And we're also a member of the UK Net Zero Carbon Building Standards Board, which is means that we're helping to set the standards for net zero carbon buildings going forwards. So really important that we've got, you know, those sustainability commitments are really underpinning our overall growth strategy. And some of you may have seen this slide before. I make no apology for showing it again, because it's really important that we are only going to grow the business in a way which is aligned to our risk appetite, doing it in a disciplined, risk-aware way. So we've got a really aligned culture within the business, and that's important. You can have whatever processes you want, but it's important that the culture and the mindset of our people is aligned to the process and aligned to the risk appetite of the group overall. The incentives of the business are all aligned, so everybody in the business is incentivized the same way. That's about profit, cash, and ESG metrics. Nobody in the business has got a revenue metric, so nobody in the business is incentivized to go and sign the wrong contracts for the wrong reasons. And it's really important to, you know, that for all of the jobs that we sign, we understand the risk inherent in those contracts, and we understand the contractual mechanisms in place to mitigate those risks. And by doing this, there is no individual job in our order book or live on the site which individually will do harm to the business, because there's no job in the business which is disproportionate to the overall portfolio of jobs in the order book. But you can see there in the middle box on the top row there, every single job in which comes across over £25 million comes to the executive board for approval. But more importantly, every single job with certain risk factors would come to the executive board for approval. So if we have a very standard piece of work that we do, you know, all the time in a particular region, and we were doing that same job in a region where we don't have the supply chain, for example, then that job would have a risk factor. It would be rated red on our risk ratings, and that would come to the executive board for approval. So focus on risk management, really, really important to the business. So high quality people, that culture of discipline and risk management, what that leads to is a really high quality order book, an order book of £3.5 billion at the end of December 2022. And every single thing in this order book has been through the risk management process that was described on the previous slide. So everything in this order book supports the strategy that we've got in place, supports our margin objective. And maybe just to call out a couple of statistics on this slide. 87% of the order book there is being awarded through frameworks. Frameworks are a mechanism to provide us with long-term visibility, long-term client relationships, established terms and conditions. These are an excellent route to market, and absolutely the vast majority of our work is won through those framework positions. You can see on the bottom right there, the median contract size in our building division is £20 million. And this means, you know, there's no individual contract which is of a size which is really going to kind of take away the portfolio effect of having 200-300 jobs on the ground at any one time. And then you can see on the top there, when we entered this calendar year, we already had 79% of work secured for the year to June 2024. So there's really good visibility, so really good long-term visibility of the workload in front of us. And that's really important, because putting this together, this strong order book really underpins then the culture of risk management. Because again, because we've got this really strong order book, nobody in the business needs to go and look for the wrong type of work. And we can make sure that all the work that we look to procure is on the right terms and conditions and supportive of our margin objectives. And this is just an example of some of those framework positions that we have in place. And you can see across all of our key sectors, we've got long-term frameworks in place. And in fact, if I extend this graphic out to 2030, a lot of these green bars would extend right further out to the right-hand side. So across all of our sectors, that framework opportunity is a really excellent route to market for us. So really, just to summarize, Sarah, Galliford is in a really strong position. We had a really good half year to December 2022. More importantly, we've got a strong outlook for the rest of this financial year to June 2023 and beyond to our strategic targets through to 2026. We're progressing very well against those targets. Importantly, we're doing and delivering exactly what we've said we would do. We're financially strong. We're operating in robust and resilient markets, and we're providing increasing shareholder returns. And as we grow our revenues to 2026, as we increase our margin through to 2026, obviously that will drive higher profit before tax and in turn higher dividends for our shareholders. And that's the strategy that we're really well placed to continue to deliver. So with that, I'm very happy to take any questions.
It heartens me when you say that macroeconomic conditions have improved, because if we were to listen to the International Monetary Fund, the economic think tank, it has the UK being doomed. But it seems as though that's not the case where your company is concerned. Now, I'm going to pick March. March was a really good month for the company, 5 announced contracts. So I'm wondering, you know, is this a typical amount of contracts, or is it the end of financial year panic where companies realise they haven't used up their entire infrastructure budget and they've got to do it before the end of March? Or is 5 contracts a month going to be the norm now? Or the
March was really good in terms of some of the size and scale of those contracts. I mean, of course, we signed a lot more than 5 contracts most months, but we had a really good March in terms of this, some of those really large contracts coming through. And really, that was just, there was a bit of coincidence of timing that they, that they kind of all came together. I don't think it was a March financial year end issue. But I think, when we talk about the order book and then we talk about the strong pipeline behind that, of course, we can see some of these awards coming through the pipeline. And so, and there is this really, there is a really resilient and robust market there. And so I think for me, I know the IMF is kind of a bit gloomy about UK growth overall, but when you look at the sectors that we operate in, the water sector, which is probably 25% of my business overall, that's driven by regulatory cycles. It's driven by the water company's requirements to continue to invest in their assets, as opposed to being driven by kind of short-term economic growth in the UK. And similarly, if I look at schools, it's driven a lot by demographics and by the aging, aging infrastructure of this kind of school estate. So there's lots of drivers for your continued progress. But you're right, March was an excellent, and of course into April as well with this morning's announcement on the Carlisle Road.
So Scott's congratulating you. He says, congratulations on the many new contracts you've announced recently. He said, he asks, what percentage of projects that you bid on do you win?
So, yes, well, firstly, Scott, thank you very much for the sentiment on the congratulations. So it's a really, interesting question, because we turn away far more work than we bid on, let alone winning. And in fact, it's very rare that we would look to bid in a completely sort of single tender process. So that's actually a big red flag for us. So because most of our work is through frameworks, of course we have to bid and win our place on those frameworks. And then frameworks work in different ways. Sometimes there'll then be a shortlist that we'll then have a competitive bidding process. Some frameworks, once we're on the framework, we get allocated work, as opposed to having to then go and bid it against others in the sector. And similarly, even the work not through frameworks, typically if a job opportunity came in which had 4 or 5 people on the list of contractors, and it's kind of put your best foot forward and the lowest price wins, we typically wouldn't bother bidding that because that doesn't align with our risk criteria. Actually, what we would typically want to do is to be appointed based on quality, so quality score metrics, and then negotiate the price. So it's a really difficult answer to give a precise number, but I can tell you, Scott, we do walk away and turn away from far more opportunities than we engage with, and that, you know, that, and then because of the way we engage, we then have a very successful, you know, conversion rate because we're typically negotiating work.
I thought it was interesting that you sort of don't get out of the corporate bed for anything less than £20 million. So that's the median contract.
Well, that's the median. So we do a lot less than that. So in building, we obviously, that's the median. So of course, there's a whole slug of contracts for less than that. In our environment business, actually a lot smaller, because often in the water sector, they'll be very much smaller. So in highways, of course, quite different, because typically highways jobs are, you know, highways jobs are typically at the more, you know, higher headline price. So there is a real range within that.
So 21st September last year, you started the share buyback program, yep, which you've referenced in this presentation. How successful an initiative has this been for you? I know it's still ongoing, but I think it's almost coming to an end, isn't it?
No, it's ongoing. We're probably about halfway through in terms of value, and we thought this would take most of the year because the, you know, £50 million, that's, you know, that was, you know, just shy of 10% of the market cap of the company when we launched it. So it was a big, you know, relatively big slug. And, you know, what we're looking to do is to do that in the market by, you know, not being too aggressive in the market, and by acting as a kind of buyer for natural sellers. And so we're pleased with how that's progressing. And of course, what that is doing is, you know, is being incremental to earnings, you know, for our remaining shareholders as well. So we're pleased that's, you know, that's a first return of additional capital. And, you know, what we've said is over the period, you know, our balance sheet is of a size to, you know, which will be satisfactory even come 2026. So actually, with the balance sheet, doesn't need to grow as we grow the business over the next, you know, 3 or 4 years as well. So yeah, there may well be opportunity for further returns in due course.
Because Ian's asking how you would describe your dividend policy. Is it progressive?
Yes. Yeah, so our dividend policy is a 2x earnings cover is our ordinary dividends policy. And of course, Ian, we don't have any, as I mentioned, any sort of pension trustees. So that means every, you know, every pound of, you know, post-tax earnings, 50p to our shareholders, and 50p we can invest back in the business. But of course, what's really important is, you know, as you do the maths, as we grow the business. So in 2021, when we set our strategy, we were at £1.1 billion and at 2% operating margin. By 2026, we'll be at £1.6 billion at 3%. So 50% higher turnover, 50% higher margin, and of course those two things compound each other. So of course, you know, we would expect the dividend growth to follow that increase in earnings because we've got that 2x dividend cover policy.
So you don't operate within a bubble. There is competition out there. It's what keeps you sharp, and obviously, yeah, you like to shout and trumpet your key differentiators. You know, Ian's wanting to know, are there any other listed companies that provide all of the services that you do?
So I think in terms of the breadth, so when you put the whole piece together, you know, of course there are other listed companies who do, you know, who we compete with in elements of, you know, different elements of the business. So parts of our building business will compete with some listed companies, whether it be Morgan Sindall or Kier. You know, our environment business then probably competes with different businesses, and similarly with highways, as opposed to it being, so the different parts of the business have, if you like, different peer groups, different competitors, whether they be listed or private companies. And of course, there are other private construction companies, Waits in, you know, in England, Robertson's in Scotland, and so on. So there is a variety, but certainly across, you know, if I pick up environment, so our water business as an example, you know, we work with all of the major water companies across the UK. And in terms of that footprint, both in terms of design and build and capital maintenance capabilities, you know, I would say that is, you know, there's no one else who's got that same coverage across the whole of the UK.
I like what you did there. I was a bit worried that we were going to be giving airtime to the competition, and that's not what you're what you're paying for. Right, when you announce targets such as ambitions for £1.6 billion revenue with 3% margins, You must be pretty confident that you're going to do that. You wouldn't have made it public otherwise, I don't think. So how likely is it that you'll over-deliver on this ambition and that you'll possibly set even grander targets from 2026?
So look, construction companies in the past have had a habit of over-promising and under-delivering. We want to make sure that we are realistic. You know, we want to be ambitious, but authentic, realistic, and make sure we do what we said we're going to do. We've done that every six-monthly period since December 2020, and we announced our strategy in 2021. We think we can grow the business because the markets are there to support that revenue growth, so we can absolutely see that trajectory coming through the pipeline. And we can see the route to get that margin up as well through the margin that embedded in our contracts and in the order book, and margin embedded in the frameworks that we're on, you know, through the efficiency and digitalization and investments that we've made in the business. So we can absolutely see the route, you know, to get to those targets. And, you know, of course, you know, I'd be absolutely delighted to come on here when we hit those targets and tell you, you know, kind of what's next. But yeah, our view is, well, let's get there. Let's hit those, you know, get to that 3%. And then we'll push on from there. But yeah, that's about making the 3% a proper sustainable margin. We don't want that to be a one-off, you know, kind of once in a lifetime hit and then come back down. That will be a proper sustainable 3%, and then we'll push on beyond that.
Well, don't be a stranger. Don't wait until you're announcing that, because your energy is infectious. It's always a pleasure to have you here, Andrew Duxbury, Finance Director of Galliford Tri. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much. Good to see you again.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, great questions. Thank you very, very much to our final presentation of the evening. And it's a double header. We're not talking about football, but Accesso Technology Group, which was very agile in providing smart technology for a post-COVID-19 world. Its initiatives include technology solutions for attractions and venues worldwide. It is expanding. Its market cap is £275 million to date. It added on an additional £1 million in 24 hours. And tonight, we are joined by the Chief Executive, Steve Brown, and Director of Group Finance, Matt Boyle. You've had a great time, and adding on £1 million onto the market cap in 24 hours. If only every day was like that, guys.
That's correct. If every day could only be that way. And, you know, our share price is obviously suppressed right now. The market is, as I keep saying, a bit grumpy. And despite fantastic results, the market is not appreciating those. So, you know, some would say that might be a buying opportunity. But, you know, that's a personal opinion, I suppose. But thank you for the time today. And thank you to everyone for joining us. We are going to use our results presentation as background for this, because it's fresh off the press last week. And I am joined today, as you said, with Matt Boyle, who is our Director of Group Finance. And so we're going to go through an overview of our business for those of you that are not as familiar with us. We have a lot to talk about on that front. I'll give some highlights of 2022. Matt will hit the highlights of the financial results, and then we'll provide a brief summary and, of course, allow time for questions, which is always my favorite part. So starting off with a business overview, this page is getting more and more busy, it seems, each time that we, you know, go to use this information. We have a lot of products, and we think about our business in two key categories: ticketing and distribution and guest experience. And within those, we have a variety of products. This business has come together and grown as the result of numerous acquisitions over the years, really about the last 10 years of acquisitions. And in our ticketing and distribution group, we have really four key products. We have Accesso Passport, Accesso Seriousware, Showware, and also Ingresso. And our ticketing business really does everything you need. One of our products will suit you, whether you have a theme park, a ski resort, a museum, a water park, an observation tower, a theater show, you name it. One of our products will fit your need if you're a place that people go to have fun, to enjoy entertainment, whatever that may be. And so we've covered those with different products. Passport is largely for general admission, high volume venues, generally theme parks. Merlin is a very large customer for us with Accesso Passport. Accesso Seriousware is divided basically between ski and cultural. So we have about 118 ski resorts in the US that utilize Accesso Seriousware. It's an on-prem solution that covers their ticketing, their food retails, ski rentals, lessons. And so it's a key product for us. We acquired that in, I guess, 2014. And we had that connected now to Accesso Passport. So the customers that are on SiriusWare can utilize the Passport e-commerce functionality, which is very robust. Showware is our assigned seating, kind of a place you go where you have a, you know, a section and a row and a seat number. That's kind of what Accesso Showware's business is all about. It's very different than a theme park. But we also cover some fairs and festivals, some more limited time engagements with Showware. And then wrapping around all of that is Ingresso, which is our third-party distribution solution. So if you're a client, I don't know, the London Eye or the Lion King on the West End, and you want to get your tickets out to the distribution market, or Viator, you need a way to connect to those systems. And that's what Ingresso does. It's a distribution connector. And we have a, both a B2B portion where we connect to suppliers and distributors. And we have a B2C portion of the business where we sell directly to customers, primarily for West End theater tickets. So we have the ticketing and distribution, you know, product range quite wide, and a whole range of functionality covered by that, all the way down to the venue level and the turnstiles and access control, all of that. In our guest experience group, we have two products, soon to be three. We have virtual queuing, which is Accesso LOQ. Many of you may have heard of that. That's kind of the foundation of the business. That was started in 2001. And in 2012, that business began this acquisition journey that we have now. And through that, it transitioned to the name of Accesso. But LOQ is kind of our foundation cornerstone company. And it's a virtual queuing product. It's not a reservation system. It's truly a virtual wait. So you can think about it being elastic. It responds to the demand and the supply that's happening at an attraction or a venue to update the customers on their smartphone primarily of their estimated wait time and their return time. So if you go to, I don't know, Legoland Windsor and you don't want to wait in the queue, you can pay for the premium service from us, and you can buy a speedy pass or speedy queue, and you can select the attraction. And when it's your turn to ride, you simply show up at the attraction and enjoy the experience. So our system can wait in line for you, and it has a lot of very advanced functionality that suits large scale venues like a theme park, as an example. So that's a very important part of our business. TE2 is really one of the more difficult to explain. I'll give you just the headline. It's the opportunity to identify individuals and their activities and then provide contextual response. So we use this system to gather data about customers, guests, and we can use their trigger of A to provide response B. So if you walk into a theme park leveraging a ticket you bought on Accesso Passport, when we scan that, we know you're there. So we can send you a push notification to your mobile app or an SMS message from LOQ saying, hey, we know you're at the park today. Would you like to buy a virtual queuing session? So the TE2 product is really quite robust in connecting that. It's not an email you get a week later. It's the real time right now. You just did this. What should we recommend? How should we contextually change the experience on that you may see on your screen? And we are, you know, we have a very large part of our business is within the cruise space with Carnival. They have this across one of their brands in a fairly extensive way. Do a lot of professional services work for them. But on our side, we are leveraging this in our product. And that's really important message for us to share is that is with every software release, this is becoming more and more part of our product. So we continue to interweave and interconnect those experiences, because that is what drives value for our customers, the venues that are using our solutions. And then last but not least, on the right, you see a dotted rectangle, and that is a food and retail platform that we are launching in the fall. We acquired the assets of a business last summer, a very, very capital efficient purchase of £750,000 for a business that I've known for most of my professional career, but they had a legacy product and they got a bit behind in the times and did not move to a more modern hosted platform, and their legacy product fell out of demand. And so they ran out of market essentially. But what we discovered in this evaluation process is they were building a new product and they had been spending a lot of cash building that. And that product was about 80% complete. And it takes all of that legacy functionality that's very robust and it moves it to a cloud product that can be multi-tenant and fully hosted. And so our part of that is we have to finish the product and take it to market, because we didn't buy the business. We didn't really want the business, the legacy, you know, customers and solution. We wanted to have the new product, go back to those customers, sell it to new customers. And so what we're doing is finishing up that product. It was about 80% done. And in fact, I spoke to them yesterday, and they have finished the first big phase, which is really a monumental element. So we have all the retail functionality finished and all of the fast food functionality, which is the majority of what our customer base needs. The remaining piece to do is some of the more unusual features that you need, check transfers between servers, but importantly, fine dining, because some of our operators do have fine dining restaurants as part of their venue. So we're launching that in 2023. You'll start hearing about that over the coming months, and our big launch will really be in the fall. But the important part about this is it's not just for theme parks, it's for hospitality in general. Casinos, hotels, resorts, anyone that's in the food or retail business, either together or separately, a pret-a-manger, for example, or a retailer, on High Street, I guess, could use this product. Venues like it because it can handle food and retail in one system. So if you're a casino, you have shops and you have restaurants, you need one system to run both. It's very, very efficient for them in terms of tech management and training and the ability to sort of cross between those products very easily. So we're really excited about this. Like I said, we could have bought a business that was much more expensive and maybe hit the ground running, but we got such a good deal on this from a cash perspective. I concluded it was more valuable to us to take that route than it would be to buy something that was perhaps in motion that had older tech. We are getting fresh, hot off the press tech here that I think is going to be very well received by the customers we serve. And, more than that, even at a broader circle of customers than we would typically think about for Accesso. We have a lot of sectors we serve. I think the key point here is we don't just serve theme parks. It's a think Accesso theme parks. We serve all kinds of venues. Ski is a big part of our business. We have live entertainment, theaters, casinos, cruise lines, fairs and festivals, observation decks like the Lift 109 at Battersea Power Station or the One World Observatory in New York. Lots of museums, a whole range of things in the hospitality space and leisure space that we're serving. So it's always an important chance to kind of course correct if someone thinks we just do theme parks. Geographically, we are very diversified. We're in 29 countries, and we have a very large scale compared to anyone in the space that's providing these types of solutions. We serve over 1,000 venues as well. So again, we're very recognized in the space, and we actually have really nominal overall competition. There's of course competition within each product, but generally speaking, there's not someone that's competing at the level we are with the scale we are capable of delivering. Top tier customer base. I think this is a page I'm very proud of. If you look across the top, you can see our flagship clients, Merlin, Six Flags, Cedar Fair, which is a similar company to Six Flags here in the US. They just don't operate under the Cedar Fair brand as much. They operate their individual names, but it's a similar size product, company. And then of course, Village Roadshow Theme Parks, which is based in Australia. And we have five of their large theme parks there, as well as a theater. So you can see the logos of the other things, other businesses we serve in each of these different sectors. The Jameson Distillery is a great one. Just to kind of highlight the diversity of what we're doing. We have 18 casinos that we're operating their theaters, their theater ticketing. And we have, the New York Botanical Gardens. We have just such a range of great logos and customers. This is just a snippet of the 1,000 venues that we serve. But it gives you, a flavor of the types of customers we're serving and also the scale. These are very high quality, sort of blue chip entertainment venues, if you will, that are our customers. So in terms of 2022 operational performance, I'll hit the highlights here. We had a record full year revenue. I'm really excited about that. Going into the year, you never quite know what to expect. You do your best with your forecast and your budgeting process, but we exceeded our own expectations. And that was in light of the fact that one of our key customers changed their strategy and moved to a lower volume, more premium strategy. And that volume impacted us on our queuing business and also ticketing. And we were able to absorb that impact and exceed our expectations. So it just kind of speaks to the underlying demand in our overall business. And the fact that we have such diversity that something that happens, even with a large customer, we have the ability to absorb that because we're so diversified, both geographically and with our product set. We have continued demand for our products across all the different sectors. Our sales to existing customers continue to be strong. Selling a customer that is using Seriousware, having them add on the e-commerce product, or taking one of our e-commerce customers and adding on the Ingresso distribution product, that continues to be an important part of our strategy and an important part of our success. we focus a lot on those kind of combination deals. So we had 25 of our customers that moved forward with adding a product. So we had 21 clients that are now using Accesso Passport against Seriousware, as I mentioned before, 25 new ones doing that. And we also signed 29 new venues that we've never worked with before, 8 of those in live entertainment, an area that is continuing to return to full strength. It is at full strength. And now the demand is actually very strong and live entertainment is back and they're upgrading technology and kind of back in full motion again. It was the last to recover. It really recovered by the middle of last year. We were back to almost 100% essentially in our showware business. They have to mount the shows, they have to hire the actors, they have to train them, costume them, they have to book the talent if it's a concert. So it took a little longer for that to get back into full swing, but now that's certainly not an issue. Things are in full tilt, so to speak, on that front. Momentum is very strong. One of the things we look at is our geographical diversity. And during 2020, 2021, we saw a lot of inconsistency as Australia was shut down for far longer than other areas. The UK had some extended closures. We are now back to our normal mix that you would have seen in 2019 in terms of how our balance comes across the different regions that we serve. We keep seeing a big growth opportunity within the ski market. 62% of the customers that were new last year came from ski. And it is something that we're focused very deeply on. Our Accesso Seriousware product is well known in the industry. We have 118 ski resorts, as I mentioned, but it is an on-prem solution. It's not cloud hosted. And today customers want cloud hosted. And so we're very focused on our product roadmap and our consideration around addressing the opportunity within ski, something that we're looking at very closely, in terms of a go forward basis, because we've got a lot of opportunity in North America, both in the US and Canada, where ski resorts tend to operate, their lift and their ski rental and their equipment. And it typically is one operator doing all of that versus European ski, where it's more fragmented. So those US or in Canadian resorts often want one system. Full steam. In fact, Accesso Showware had record unit sales and record revenue in 2022, which just demonstrates the fact that it's back at full tilt. We also signed a new queuing customer. We don't sign new enterprise queuing customers very often because the number of venues that are busy on enough days to need technology to solve their queuing is a somewhat limited audience. It's typically much bigger venues with high volume. And we did sign an operator that's in Spain. And we installed 4 new European theme parks and 2 US theme parks last year. And we have 3 more actually slated for this year operation. So we're really pleased to have brought that customer into the fold on our LOQ solution. And these are important wins for us to see a customer like that coming in and moving to a more modern product for how they manage their queues. We also continue to have cross-sell success. I mentioned Accesso Passport and Seriousware quite a bit. We sold 9 million tickets through Passport that came from our Seriousware customers. And Ingresso, our distribution service, sold 2.9 million tickets that were our own tickets for our own customers. And that was double what it was in 2021. So just overall, very, very strong momentum and not just in one area, kind of across our product set and across our sectors that we serve. Enterprise customers are super important. We do have a significant amount of large customers. We announced a 5-year renewal with Cedar Fair, and also Village Roadshow signed for 5 years with an additional 2. So these customers continue to believe in us and really sign up for us for long time periods. Innovation, lots going on there. I'm not going to go into a lot on this front. I mentioned the food and retail platform. We've spent a lot of money on R&D, keeping our product fresh and contemporary. And we're always looking to bring new products to market. So this is a super important part of our brand and how we operate and something that people expect from us. People and culture, last but not least, a couple of key points here. We had 15% employee turnover last year. We really pride ourselves in employee satisfaction and employee engagement. We also received our highest employee engagement score we received in the entire time we've been doing that survey. So really great on the employee front. And we have such a great group of people. We're all working remote now. It's going extremely well, allowing us to be more flexible and recruit more quickly. So overall, I think from a people and operational perspective, we haven't been in this good of a position in a very long time. So very pleased with that. So moving on, I'm going to let Matt pick up and just run through some key points on financials. You can obviously read these in the presentation that's been provided, but Matt will hit the highlights for us.
Thanks, Dave. So we released our financials last week, which hopefully everyone has seen. And as Steve mentioned, we had record revenue, which was really pleasing. So $139.7 million, which was 12% up on the prior year. The makeup of that revenue was broadly comparable to the prior year. The transactional revenue, again, makes up the vast majority of it. Our cash EBITDA was $25.8 million. That was slightly down on last year, but really positive for us because we're expecting it at the start of the year, we're expecting it to be a bit lower, having expected wage inflation and increased headcount at the back end of 2021, as well as that headwind with the larger US customer that Steve mentioned earlier. So $25.8 million was a really positive result for us. We ended the year with $64.7 million of cash in the bank. And we are undrawn with our existing line of credit, which is 18 million GBP. The next slide shows our revenue streams, revenue by type. Again, I can see there that transactional makes up the bulk of it and had a really exceptional year. Most of that was driven by our distribution business coming back online, which is, as Steve mentioned, is our largely West End theatre ticketing and also as Accesso passport customers utilising it. Other key points to pull out there, we also had an uplift of 18.7% of in our professional services business. So that is us servicing those larger customers. Steve mentioned Carnival earlier, which we do a lot of work for. We had a slight drop in hardware, but that is a cyclical business, and there were no significant orders last year, but it repeats year every other year typically. The other line that you see there of 3.4 million benefits from largely from a release of expired gift cards actually that we were issued during COVID and no longer able to be used. So we did benefit from that for about a million GBP during the year. Next slide. This is a summarized income statement. So I guess the key point to put out here is the slight drop in gross margin from 77.2% to 74.4%. Again, that's really a mechanic of our distribution business coming back online. So it operates at a much lower margin than our typical ticketing, e-commerce and queuing businesses. And as it becomes a larger part of our sales mix or returns to being a part of our sales mix, our margin drops accordingly. But 74.4% is sort of our normal margin and where we were pre-COVID and where we'd expect it to be going forward. We've got an increase of 10.1% in our admin expenses there. And that's really just a reflection of a number of factors, but largely our headcount. We had a net increase of 55 heads during the year. And that contributed to that, as well as the wage inflation of our and retention of our existing staff. Next slide is our alternative performance measures. So this takes us from our operating profit statutory measure down to the cash EBITDA, which is our preferred presentation. The key points to put out there, I guess, are we've got $137,000 in our related to the retail food and beverage acquisition that Steve mentioned. There's also quite a bit lower amortization in the current year, and that's related largely to the runoff of the acquired intangibles. So our last acquisition was at the back end of 2017, so we've got the runoff of that, as well as our just lower amortization following lower capitalized R&D expenses over the last few years. So that's 10.7 versus the 12.1 in the previous year. We did capitalize 2.2 million of cost during the year, which is over double the amount we capitalized in the previous year for a number of reasons. So two of which are we just had a higher headcount on a slightly higher wage, as well as the fact that we continue to capitalize the cost that Steve mentioned related to the forthcoming launch of our new retail food and beverage application, which is in that number. The final slide, so this is our summarized cash flow statement. So the key points to put out here, I guess, are we had lower cash generated from operations, but that is largely a working capital movement. We had quite a real tough end really to the end of the 2021 with the Omicron variant closing most of our larger venues, certainly in the UK, whereas it's typically a very cash generative period. Whereas we had the opposite in December 2022, where lots of our venues were open and trying to make the most of being open for the first time in a couple of years. So we had a large working capital swing there that will unwind as we go through 2023. Other points to put out there. So we've got the purchase in dollars of 1.1 million of the retail food and beverage platform. That's the intangible assets line. We had just under $6 million of purchase of our own shares for the benefit of our employee benefit trust. And then lastly, we had $2.5 million, of an exchange loss. So we do hold GBP. We have expenses and customers in GBP, and we report in USD. So that is as the GBP depreciates against the dollar. That is that's what you saw there in the 2.5 million. Again, we ended the year on 64.7 million. And we continue to hold the facility with Investec of $18 million sterling, and it is undrawn. And Steve can take you through the summary and outlook.
Thank you, Matt. And I think we covered, the main points in the summary here. The big thing is, what do we think about the year? Macroeconomic is, we're kind of a reverse elastic company, I guess you could say, in regards to that, because most of the venues we serve are local in nature. And when people are substituting more expensive travel or more expensive entertainment, they often go to a local theme park or local theater versus something that involves airfare and hotels and other expenses. So we actually have not seen an impact from the macroeconomic environment. And in fact, I should literally just looking at the results for March, which we're now tallying, and year to date, we're not seeing any sign of that, and actually quite the opposite. I just saw in the news today that Delta Airlines announced they have record summer bookings. So we're just not seeing that impact in terms of, people wanting to get out and have fun. Maybe they're trading other things off, but that is not what we're seeing in the customers that we serve. And we have a lot of cash, so we're obviously thinking a lot about our balance sheet. And, we're going to, in the next three to six months, we're going to make some decisions around our go-forward path in regards to M&A, if we haven't found something interesting, which is clearly our number one priority. Beyond that, then we would obviously be looking at a share buyback and or a dividend. So those are kind of our key points, I think, in terms of the overall presentation. And, there's questions coming in, I think, and I'm happy to jump into those and take others that may surface along the way.
Well, Steve, well, Matt, thank you very much indeed. Matt, welcome to the proactive world. It's lovely to have you joining us. A lovely summary there. Right at the beginning, Steve. You referenced a very busy, crowded slide in terms of technology diversity. So yeah, it is a bit of a hectic slide. And just to be devil's advocate, do you have the capacity to cope with growth? Because 2022 was a very good year for you.
We do. And I think it's part of just what we've been working on, is building out that foundation, the organizational structure alignment after having done all of those acquisitions. They were all independent companies, and bringing those together organizationally across engineering and product and finance, we are in a great position on that front. It's a lot of work, the work we focused on during 2020 when people were busy doing other things. We were busy kind of sorting out our P's and Q's, you could say, on our staffing and where people sit and who they report to and finding efficiencies. And so we've now, we have a much more organized structure. And I think we're very well equipped, probably better than we've ever been in terms of absorbing additional, M&A activity, new customers, implementation, whatever it may be. So yeah, I think we're very well positioned on that front.
So in terms of absorption, I can see 55 new personnel joining you. And Dave Hollins says, have you been able to pick up any talented technology specialists as a result of all the layoffs from the tech giants?
Well, we haven't been hiring, any massive numbers in the recent months when those have really been most, most noticeable. What's really helped us is moving up to the remote workforce, because we were only hiring around our Orlando office, our Twyford office, our Fresno office, for example. And that's limiting in terms of the available population and the talent we need across certain technologies. And so moving to the ability to hire essentially anywhere has really changed our ability to get great talent. Sometimes the pricing is better in different markets, but also fill the jobs faster so we can get the work done. And I can tell you our employees are super happy about it. And if we weren't following that path, we would have a very difficult time hiring because companies of our size are left and right allowing work from home, and they would choose those companies over us. So it's a competitive decision, but I would say it's working extremely well.
I was very excited by the way that you describe the food and beverage technology as fresh, hot off the press tech. It had me salivating at it, but it had Jake a little bit worried. He says, is most of the technology patented? Because, you know, it's fresh, hot off the press, but there might not be any, you know, locked in IP.
You know, there we do have actually quite a wide portfolio of patents, a lot of them around our queuing business, a lot in our TE2 product. You know, a lot of it's in the know-how, and, you know, you can try to build something and compete, but we have so many years of experience and so much fine tuning that honestly, I think more about that than I do a patent. And these days, you know, technology patents are very often very difficult to defend. And so we look more for the innovation and the experience and the quality and the reliability of what we can deliver than we do the patents. But I was on a call last week chasing the team about something we're working on and asking why it hasn't been filed yet for patent. So we still make that an important part of our product. And sometimes it's not the whole thing, it's a feature. The feature we think within the food and retail or the feature within queuing that individually is so specific, that may only be the patent, not the whole thing. But those are the roadblocks of someone copying what we're doing when we have something that's so crucial that we figured out with our experience and we are able to protect it. So it is an important part of our approach to our products.
So Matt, right at the end there, I don't know whether Steve was throwing you a curveball. I'm quite sure he didn't. But he sort of lobbed in, well, you know, we're always on the lookout for some decent acquisitions, and if not, that we could do share buyback or, you know, give the shareholders some dividends. Now, share buybacks, Matt, as you know, have become quite a thing, and when the RNSs are released in the morning, it's mainly transaction in owned shares. It's quite a thing. So if you had entire control of the purse strings, which you don't quite, what would be your preference? Would it be for share buyback, you know, dividends or an acquisition? Is it all up in the air still? Because you've got loads of money, you should be doing something with it.
Yeah, I think Steve could answer that as well as I could. We obviously do have a very large cash balance that we've had the question certainly for the last 18 months quite regularly, what do we do with it? Our preference has always been, I think, very clear that we're M&A focused. If there's something in the market that fits our need, we're not going to go spending wildly on something that we don't think add value to the business, to our product set, or wider marketplace, then that would be our number one priority. But again, if we can't find anything that meets that criteria, then we are obviously looking at the other options, be it share buyback or dividends.
And we could have made some acquisitions, checked the box and said, oh, we bought something, everyone's happy, we spent some cash. But I think we're being much more disciplined in our approach. The things that are often for sale are not things we're interested in. They're for sale for a reason sometimes. Technology, debt, you know, market, you know, challenges, whatever. And so we have a very, I think, discriminating view on any acquisitions, you know, in the past and going forward. We've learned a lot from the ones we've already made. You know, my filter is pretty intense around what fits the bill for us. And we don't want to buy a project to fix. You know, that's really a criteria. The global reach is a criteria. This key sector is an important portion for us. So, you know, we're turning over the rock, so to speak, looking for those opportunities and then matching them up against our needs. You know, it takes some work to do that. And so, you know, 18 months isn't that long in the scheme of things, but we have been thinking about it quite a lot. And if we, you know, we can't find fantastic opportunities that we think are really going to be important in the longer term to fuel our growth, we'll start, you know, doling the money back in some form.
You talked very briefly about consumer behavior. They want to go out and they want to have fun. There's a cost of living crisis here in the UK. So from the data and the intelligence that you're harvesting, you know, people, apart from going skiing, you talked about skiing an awful lot. Are you getting a sense that there is a cost of living crisis, or is that just bad fake news?
I think in the it's not fake news in the broader world, perhaps, but in the fact that people still want to have fun, the venues we operate are a great alternative for them to have fun locally without spending lots of money on airfare and hotels. And so I think that's why our demand profile is always held up during recessions. You know, I owned the Accesso Passport business in 2008, deep recession. And I was almost embarrassed telling my friends how well we were doing because the locations we were serving were so busy. And so it's, people don't quite understand that. You know, one of the articles that came out on our results day mentioned consumer spending and worried about our company. And I thought they got it completely wrong because I don't think that is how this business operates. And the operators have such large fixed expenses that they're very motivated to keep the volume coming. And so they will adjust their pricing strategies and their offers to keep the volume in, and they'll adjust against the affordability. So on our end, they need to hold a revenue base, whether it's with 100 people or 150 people, they still need the revenue, right? So they adjust their pricing to keep the revenue flowing and cover their fixed costs. So we generally have been insulated on that front.
So speaking of people, Dave's asking, how big is your sales force in North America? There are unimaginable number of potential customers, so it would be interesting to know.
Yeah, our overall sales and marketing team is about 30 people in total when you look at it. And the sales and marketing kind of cross over because that's trade shows, that's individual cold calling on different venues. It's inbound inquiries and handling those, you know, lots of demos of product, meeting with clients, assessing their needs. And so it's, you know, I think we're very efficient on that front, actually. And it's something that I think we do very well. We have a very good reputation in terms of how we sell. We're not that sort of annoying, you know, banging on your door all the time. We have a very good reputation in the sectors we serve as being a good partner and taking that sales approach. But we're always looking to right size. We've got the food and retail platform coming online and, you know, other considerations. So we're always looking and adjusting. And one of the things I call out in our statement is, you know, we don't work with a certain number of headcount. We work with the opportunities and we put people against them as we think they're valuable. And we have more people than we've ever had, and we're making more money than we've ever made. And so, you know, it's a tough balance, but I think part of what we do is a very disciplined focus on how those people are deployed and keeping that as efficient as possible. So, but not holding our growth back because we won't hire the people. It's an important
factor. Understood. But what something is holding something back, though, because Jake says, thank you very much for the presentation. He thanks you. The news and results coming from the company seem really positive. However, the share price is struggling. What do you think the disconnect is between the company's performance and its share price?
I have a theory. I can't prove this, but you know, we spoke to shareholders last week, all of our major shareholders, and they all had a little bit different opinion. But the consensus is that our large shareholders aren't selling. They all realize our price is an opportunity. They see our targets in the market. So if you look at our volumes, you're not going to see any of the big, you know, 10, top 10, top 20 moving big blocks of shares. What we're seeing is the middle-sized funds are needing liquidity in some cases, and so they're either automatically selling shares. Individual traders are moving 50 shares, 100 shares. So we've got a little bit of a soft demand, a little output, but not a big demand, right? Because there's not a lot of cash on the middle-sized market, and the large shareholders aren't releasing their shares for someone else to buy. So we're a little stuck, to be honest. You know, it's frustrating, but our underlying performance is very strong, and we're confident that when the grumpy mood moves along and people start, you know, moving, it'll bounce back pretty quickly. That's kind of the working assumption. But it is frustrating, I'll tell you, to have results like this and wake up and see your share price, you just sort of shake your head. But I see that as an opportunity. You know, it's an opportunity for people to get in. It's an opportunity for us to, you know, bring new people into the group and to just keep trying to do better and better. But it doesn't concern me, except that it's frustrating. I think it's a structural issue with the market. There's certainly nothing within our business that anyone has raised concern about. It's just a sector, you know, in the moment. I think when SVB hit, that's really when we dropped from sort of 8 to back into the 6s. It dropped very quickly. Otherwise, we were doing very well. And I think there's just some, you know, cash outflow versus inflow still happening, particularly in the UK, more so there than the US. The US doesn't seem to have the same kind of mood that we see in the UK.
So, Matt, let's remind investors of a glorious sentence that appeared in the last RNS. In 2022, we delivered a record year for revenue, continuing our robust growth trend, as well as very strong cash EBITDA, beating our expectations. Will I be reading the same type of sentence this time next year, Matt?
There's nothing has happened in the first few months of the year that would suggest otherwise. Certainly our initial expectations are along those lines. And despite the consumer cost of living crisis that you mentioned earlier, as Steve said, the businesses and trade that we operate in aren't typically seeing much of an impact of that yet. So there's no reason why we shouldn't be giving a similar message this time next year.
And we don't like to disappoint. That's our track record. And we share I share my ambition as the last presenter did. It's not a forecast, but it's ambition of $200 million in revenue with at least a 20% margin by 2025. And I just reiterate that because I think it's a very feasible objective for us as a business. And so our focus is on growth and just continuing to operate as efficiently as possible to grow the margin.
I'm loving you too, the diplomat and the dynamo. It's an absolute pleasure, Matt and Steve. Thank you very, very much indeed. Steve Brown, Chief Executive, Matt Boyle, Director of Group Finance, Accesso Technology Group. What a wonderful way to end tonight's event. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you as always.
Thank you.
And thank you to you all for attending. Thanks to the presenters tonight, to our Global Events Director, Thomas Coleman. The next event is next Thursday, the 20th of April. It's an in-person physical event at the Chesterfield Hotel in Mayfair, when we will be hosting the following: Anglo-Asian Mining, Crossword Cybersecurity, Xeros Technology Group, and Wise Alpha Technologies. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Thanks for joining us. Cheerio.